At our first NTCOF service in 1995, we had a dramatization of a letter that T.H. Huxley wrote to a guy named Charles Kingsley. So that's T.H. Huxley on the left, and I'll tell you who the other guy is in a minute. Thomas Henry Huxley wrote this letter to Kingsley on September 23rd of 1860. Thomas Henry Huxley, T.H. we'll just call him, he was the grandfather of the famous Aldous Huxley. You've all heard of The Brave New World and some of those books, so it's all there. It's like a big Huxley family dynasty over there. T.H. was known in his day as Darwin's bulldog because of his vigorous defense of the evolution theories of his friend Charles Darwin. And there's a somewhat legendary account of T.H. having an encounter with the Bishop Samuel Wilberforce. That's him on the right. In fact, they actually called him Soapy Sam because he would tend to kind of rub his hands around like that, just sort of a habit. It looked like he was washing his hands all the time. So they held a debate about 7 months after the publication of Darwin's On the Origin of Species at Oxford, and of course no recordings exist that could do that then, but there are many different accounts from different people of what happened. But what does seem certain is that Wilberforce sarcastically at one point during the thing, they were not actually debating each other, but maybe it was afterwards, and he asked T.H. whether his monkey ancestors were on his grandmother's side or his grandfather's side. And T.H. is said to have made a sensation by replying as follows. A man has no reason to be ashamed of having an ape for his grandfather. If there were an ancestor whom I should feel shame in recalling, it would rather be a man of restless and versatile intellect who, not content with success in his own sphere of activity, plunges into scientific questions with which he has no real acquaintance, only to obscure them by an aimless rhetoric and distract the attention of his hearers from the real point at issue by eloquent digressions and skilled appeals to religious prejudice. Burned him to the ground. Later in 1860, T.H. suffered a great blow in the form of the death of his not quite four-year-old son, Noel. The cleric, Charles Kingsley, the guy on the left here, of course that's T.H. again on the right, he wrote him saying that T.H. ought to look forward to seeing his child again in an afterlife. T.H. responded earnestly and passionately, giving a brief account of his principled views that T.H. would later coin a new term to describe his beliefs, and he called it agnosticism. This is the guy that invented that term, agnosticism. There are a number of quotable passages in Huxley's letter to Kingsley, among them being T.H.'s saying that from his reading, led me to know that a deep sense of religion was compatible with the entire absence of theology. Secondly, science and her methods gave me a resting place independent of authority and tradition. Thirdly, love opened up to me a view of the sanctity of human nature and impressed me with a deep sense of responsibility. And he went on to say, if at this moment I am not a worn-out, debauched, useless carcass of a man, if it has been or will be my fate to advance the cause of science, if I feel that I have a shadow of claim on the love of those about me, if in this supreme moment when I look down into my boy's grave, my sorrow was full of submission and without bitterness, it is because these agencies have worked upon me, and not because I've ever cared whether my poor personality shall remain distinct forever from the all from which it, from whence it came and whither it goes. So here we see a point of view with which we can all agree, I think, and that we all share. Anybody think there's anything wrong with that? Here also is the idea of religion, free of superstition, of rational religion, even if there can never really be scientific religion, because it has to do with our subjective sense of ourselves and of life. And that is the essence of what we're trying to do here at the North Texas Church of Freethought. So in 10 more days, it's Valentine's Day, the holiday that celebrates love. As important as people say it is, it's surprising that it's a minor holiday. Certainly you don't get the day off. And then again, all the other holidays are expressions of love, perhaps. They just fly under other banners like generosity, goodwill, appreciation, sympathy, gratitude, and so on. And more about love in just a bit. Today's bulletin contains some material on the subject as well. And feel free to take extra bulletins. I think there's plenty. Everybody can take several. And leave them about where others might find them. February 4th also is the day in 1789 when George Washington was unanimously elected the first president of the United States by the Electoral College. See, as you go about your day, you're going to share these little things, and people are going to think, yeah, you're so brilliant. It's also the date in 1861 when delegates from six of the southern breakaway states formed the Confederacy. So there were seven originally. So the laser pointer is not working or something, but it's not showing up. They created this constitution, the Confederate Constitution, which they adopted a few days later. It was largely copied from the U.S. Constitution, except for explicitly naming and giving centrality to the institution of slavery. A Confederate congressman from Alabama said of this in a speech that year. This is pretty shocking, so cover your eyes if you want. We have dissolved the late Union chiefly because of the Negro quarrel. We have now placed our domestic institution and secured its rights unmistakably in the Constitution. We have sought by no euphony to hide its name. We have called our Negroes slaves, and we have recognized and protected them as persons and our rights to them as property. How can any reasonable person claim that the American Civil War was not about slavery, or that the Southern cause was any better than Hitler's cause? Let's not sanitize it. It's dirty, terrible. Facebook was founded on this day in 2004. We're 10 years older than they are. Think about that. Church has been around for longer than Facebook. February 4th is the birthday of composer Johann Ludwig Bach, the guy on the far left there, not to be confused with his second cousin, Johann Sebastian Bach. Also, the civil rights activist, Rosa Parks, there in the middle, who in 1955 refused to give up her seat in the colored section of a Montgomery, Alabama bus to a white passenger when the white section of the bus was filled. Can you imagine how idiotic it would be if people were treated differently because they're right-handed or left-handed or their hair was straight or curly? Just nuts how this country has come along. It's also the birthday in 1921 of women's rights activist Betty Friedan. She was the writer and the author of the 1964 bestseller, The Feminine Mystique, which sort of tore the coverings off of how women were treated and the consequences, how they felt from being relegated to a domestic status in those days. Now, Friedan, interestingly enough, died in 2006, also on February 4th. February 4th is World Cancer Day, as well as, get this, National Creative Vacuum Day. You want a creative vacuum? They'll suck up suck something out with a straw. And it's National Homemade Soup Day. You needed to know that, believe, trust me. One more topical item that really must be mentioned. Ursula K., and I hesitated to put this in because we have a lot of other material today. Ursula K. Le Guin died this past January 20th. How many know who Ursula K. Le Guin was? Quite a few, okay. So she was a writer primarily of fantasy and science fiction. She wrote, for example, the Earthsea series, as well as the first one I ever read of hers was that one down the bottom middle, Left Hand of Darkness. Just a tremendous story. But if you like Dune and complex, I would say it's superior to Dune. Also, she wrote The Lathe of Heaven, which was adapted at least a couple of times, I believe, to TV or movies. She was described in the New York Times in 2016 as America's greatest living science fiction writer. And I certainly think a good case could be made for that. She was also a freethinker who was very critical of supernaturalist religions, for which she was awarded the Freedom From Religion Foundation's Emperor Has No Clothes Award in 2009. So here's a couple of things from Ursula K. Le Guin's writings that reflected her thinking. I talk about the gods. I am an atheist, but I'm an artist, too. She's talking about being a writer, of course, and therefore a liar. Distrust everything I say. I'm telling the truth. The only truth I can understand or express is, logically defined, a lie. Psychologically defined, a symbol. Aesthetically defined, a metaphor. It's a great way to describe good fiction, including the Bible. Much of it. She also said, to be an atheist is to maintain God. His existence or his non-existence, it amounts to much the same on the plane of proof. Thus, proof is a word not often used among the Hondurata, one of the alien races, I think, in her writings, who have chosen not to treat God as a fact, subject either to proof or to belief, and they have broken the circle and go free to learn which questions are unanswerable and not to answer them. This skill is most needful in times of stress and darkness. really a good thought, to learn which questions are unanswerable and then not try to answer them. I thought that was very good. So this also reflects an opinion among many of us that the label atheist just gives too much credit to the idea of deities as anything other than fairy tales. Just as it would call attention to and give status to Hinduism and Islam if Christians, or atheists, were to be labeled disbelievers in karma and non-Muslims. I also found online an interesting comment by a Baptist minister and managing editor of Christianity Today in the wake of Le Guin's death, entitled, "What an Atheist Writer Taught This Christian." And this consisted, he talks about two things he learned from Ursula K. Le Guin. I think he describes interviewing her and, of course, reading some of her works. One of the things that he learned is about the enormous value of the life we've been given. Religion should never make life less happy, less rich, less fulfilling. It should never make people worse, less merciful, less gracious, less generous. His teaching about an eternal life should never justify us not making this one as good as we can for as many as we can. Kind of wonder what his commitment is to Christianity. The other is that I saw clearly as a Christian that atheists can live meaningfully without God in terms that make sense to them and that are not inherently foolish. That's what the storyteller's gifts can do and why all Christians should read good fiction. It makes you see the world through other people's eyes. Do I think they're right? No. I'd love to convince them otherwise, but I don't think I can do that by rubbishing their beliefs or assuming that they just haven't thought things through. And I guess, you know, we should think about that too. It's not that maybe people haven't thought things through. I mean, everybody can't think everything through. So we're going to think about love. We do need to think about loving our believer, fellow humans too. But really, this is a remarkable admission, and it is as remarkable and welcome that a Christian minister could learn such things from Le Guin and her writings, and I think it's a welcome and a hopeful thing. So, this church does not have dogmas and doctrines. There are no beliefs you have to take on faith or that you have to sign a statement, and we're going to kick you out if you have doubt about them, but this is what we have for now, a brief expression of what we aspire to, and we're always interested in what you think of it. If we could boil it down even more, we used to have a longer statement, but this is kind of where we're at currently. The most effort is put into our monthly service, but we have other things going on every month. These are on the back page of the bulletin, which if you lose yours, it's available online when our webmaster gets a chance to put it up for this month. But previous months have the same information. We can always do more, but it takes people to come up with ideas, and especially people to help us put the ideas into action. How about any of you, right? No pressure, but think about it. Use your imagination, put your free thinking into action, and of course no one makes any money from our church other than the hotel and everybody that we may buy stuff from. The biggest payoff is a genuine satisfaction that comes from participating in this little tiny step towards a future without supernaturalism and a better world. Medium.com has got, the laser thing is working a little bit. Medium.com, and I don't know how many of you have been there, but we have a bunch of stuff out there, mainly bulleted texts that have not been edited down to fit the bulletin. Facebook and Twitter were there. And go check out our YouTube channel at NT Church of Freethought. We have a lot of videos out there. Now, how many are there, John? A couple of dozen at least, huh?
Yeah, probably about 30.
Yeah, all right. Kit and Merlin are on hand for Child Care Sunday School. They need and welcome the help of others in this because many hands make short work. And I guess there weren't any kids to go look after. The ones we have are all old enough to behave themselves or have the video game. That always seems to pacify them. Next month on March 4th, we're going to have guest speakers, Rex Burks, that's him on the left, and Owen Younger. Rex came to our service last month, but I don't see him here now. These are the people, like many of us, that were raised to be devout fundamentalist Christians, but also like us, facts and reason had their way with them. And they went on to visit a wide range of Christian Sunday school Bible study classes, and they're going to be sharing the insights they gained from that, and of course, we'll have some question and answer discussion after that. Should be a very good session, I think. Today we begin with part two of John Gaultier's three-part series on logical fallacies. And what are fallacies anyway? They're mistakes in reasoning. And reasoning is something that we call ourselves freethinkers, rationalists, unbelievers, humanists, atheists, agnostics, that we put a very high value on. because we take the reasoning, apply the facts to evidence, even if the facts are to a great extent drawn from our subjective perceptions, as in religion, is the best way to make sense of our lives and is, in practical terms, our religion, as T.H. Huxley and others have said. Accordingly, as the whole process of gaining knowledge and understanding is a process of trial and error, if it is of vital importance to know about reasoning, then it's vitally important to know how reasoning can go wrong. And as was pointed out last month, but always bears repeating here, good judgment comes from experience, and experience comes from bad judgment. The trick is to learn not just from our own experience, but to learn from the mistakes of others. So John is going to present part two of this series. Part three. Part three, maybe we're going to wait until April because of the guest speakers coming next time. I think we'll probably do it that way. And I hope that John will present further, that I can persuade him, because this is something we should talk about frequently. It should be a kind of a recurring feature. So we need to know this. It's important material. And plus, it's fun.
Held to be false because the argument for it is fallacious. And we'll see this one in politics also. The conclusion is all vases are plants. Well, a supporting premise of this argument is false, and most people know that daisies are not trees. So the supporting premise of the argument is false, therefore this argument is fallacious. But note that the conclusion of the argument can still be true, and that's why you see it used in politics all the time. It's sort of almost similar to a straw man putting up an argument that is fallacious, and then using that to demonstrate that the conclusion that the argument seeks is false when it's not really supported by the argument. Modal scope fallacy is one in which the scope of a modal term of a premise is ambiguous, such that the conclusion could be either true or false, depending on the interpretation of the scope. So here's an example here. All that glitters is not gold. All right? This could be either, the conclusion could be either true or false of this, because you have to look at the meaning that's where the not is distributed in this term. So this could be, it's false if you're, what you're really saying is all that glitters is non-modal, right? Because the scope of the modal term not applies just to the word gold in this case. It's a matter of interpretation. What does the not apply to? It's true, the conclusion is true, if what they really meant, the scope of the term not, is for the whole sentence, for the whole phrase. Not all that glitters is gold. That's a true conclusion. All right, so here's another one. Affirming the constant. Remember, there's conditional relationship. A is the antecedent, B is the consequent. If A, then B. All right, so there's the form, right? If A, then B, premise B. If you say premise B is true, is what this really means here, therefore, A. All right, so in this argument, you're confusing the direction of the conditional relationship. You're asserting that the consequent is true, not the antecedent is true. All right, so here's an example. It's raining, the streets are wet. The second premise, the streets are wet. If you assume that both of those premises are true, the conclusion is it's raining. Well, that's a fallacious argument, because it's, you know, if it's, the streets could be wet for another reason. Right? So it's getting things confused here. So it's also known as asserting the consequent. All right, and then there's another logical fallacy, denying the antecedent. An argument which confuses the direction of a conditional relationship, which asserts that the antecedent is false. And this one is a little tricky. So the form is, if A, then B. We all recognize that one, conditional relationship. And in this case, the premise is not A, all right? Therefore not B, all right? So here's where it goes. The example of this is, if it's raining, the streets are wet. We've seen this before, right? And then saying, well, it's not raining. Therefore, the streets are not wet. Well, that's not necessarily true from this form of argument. The streets could be, once again, wet for another reason. It's just rearranging the Boolean logic of the argument in a way that's not a valid argument. All right, so there's an example right there of how you fix it, right? Instead of saying not A, you say not B, therefore not A. Now it's a valid form, right? And now this is no longer a fallacious argument. There's the correction of the logic, right? If it's raining, the streets are wet. The streets are not wet, therefore it's not. Another form of deductive fallacy, improper transposition. This one was a little bit harder for me to follow and how different it was from the prior one. It says the antecedent and the consequence of the conclusion of transposition are in the wrong order. All right. So once again, if you look carefully at the form, we're just playing with different orientations of the Boolean logic of A and B. Right. It says if the premise is if A then B, therefore if not A, then not be, right? So an example, and this one was a little harder for me to figure out because you have to kind of come up with an example. You've always heard the expression, where there's smoke, there's fire. Well, take that and turn it around, all right? And that's how you transpose the antecedent and the consequent of that particular example, but that's the best one that I could find. It's also known as negating antecedent of consequence, which is exactly what it's doing. It's taking the Boolean expression of this argument and then knotting the two terms, A and B. This one is a little easier to recognize. Affirming a disjunct. When you have two disjuncts in an OR statement, which is a disjunct by definition, two terms on either side of an OR, there are assumed to be contraries when they're not. Right? So the form is A or B, and then assume A is true, therefore not B. Okay? So an example is the politician is inept or evil. And if you assume the first premise is true, and you assume the politician is inept, well, that means the politician is not evil. But that, because what that's doing is it's assuming that these two statements are contraries. All right? So it may be possible that the politician is evil and inept, which a lot of people have here probably believe about their politicians. This one's got a lot of, also known as fallacy of the alternative syllogism, asserting an alternative, and the improper disjunctive syllogism. Oh, sure, boy, that sounds, existential fallacy. This one is really not quite as interesting to me, but I've got a good example. This is an argument in which the conclusion implies that class in the premise has at least one member when the premise does not imply this. So that one class in the premise, all unicorns are animals. All right, well, that presumes that there is at least one unicorn in existence, right? So the set of all the unicorns may actually be zero. So the conclusion is some animals are unicorns, right? So once again, there's also a little different term, description for this, the fallacy of existential assumption. And that is all we have for part two. In part three, we'll start looking at some informal fallacies in around the April time.
Thank you, John. I think we're just going to call John a professor from now on because, but you know, sometimes you need that kind of thing. This is, of course, formal logic. By the way, who all knows Steve Martin? Did you know that, you know, the comedian Steve Martin, you know? He took classes in philosophy and logic. That's something he was interested in. Happened to see that in his one of his autobiographical books. So I'll toggle back. All right. So thanks very much, John, and we'll have part three in April then. So the article in today's bulletin, as I said, contains useful information on the subject of love as an object of rational study and as a religious experience. And really, you think about it, it's both. It's worth calling attention, as it does, to the fact that all this terrible interruptions there. All this business about the traditional religions being about love becomes a bit harder to believe when it's realized that their holy books have less to say about the matter than, say, the dialogues of Plato or the writings of Aristotle and others who lived before and around the time of the holy books being written. Okay. A lot of theology completely misses or inverts the idea of love. Logical fallacies. So, for example, what earthly father or mother would want to punish with eternal torture their own child for any reason, let alone for the offense of not believing in or trusting the parent? Or take another example that requires a little bit of thought. Remember the death of T.H. Huxley's son, Noel, and the efforts of Charles Kingsley and others, no doubt, to try to console him with the idea that he'll be reunited someday with his son in an afterlife. And people just automatically seem to assume that this is a loving thing. The idea of a joyous afterlife in which people are reunited with those they loved and lost continues to be accepted today. Even many of us atheists consider that, well, that's an important reason why people cling to their supernatural religions. Really? Think about it. If your child dies, what does it mean that what does it mean that you will see them again? You'll see them again as a child. But that's not what people are deprived of when you have a child that dies. What you're deprived of is the joy and satisfaction of raising the child, of seeing them grow and mature and go off into the world to make their own life, establish their own family, and accomplish whatever remarkable things that they may do. And that loss cannot be made up for. seeing them again after many years when the parents have themselves, you turned into a different person. It is not loving to ignore what has really been lost or to suggest that it can be made up for in an afterlife. Really, it's cold-hearted, if not monstrous. The ancient Greeks, from which Christians and civilization generally heavily borrowed, came up with a much more interesting and better thought-out ideas about love. Before the Gospels had been dreamed of, Socrates, or at any rate Plato, considered and wrote about such ideas, and that's where we get the idea of platonic versus non-platonic or sexually oriented love. The Greeks had in mind even more distinctions, and these are listed in today's bulletin. And a Christian, really Greek idea of agape, who's heard of that, agape? Have any Christian background, you know that the idea of agape is mentioned by Christians and related to a deeply religious idea in the bulletin of feeling as though one is connected to the eternal or one with everything. Valentine's Day, in contrast, is connected with what the Greeks called eros, or sexually oriented love. And this is certainly the sort of love with which artists, poets, writers, composers, and singers have been preoccupied for as long as there have been such people. The major theme is the irrationality of this emotion. Cupid shoots an arrow, and the target or targets are smitten. Of course, if one person is smitten and the object of their affections is not, then you get drama. Or two people are smitten with each other, but the relationship is somehow kind of socially incorrect, doesn't really fit. There's more drama. And think Romeo and Juliet, for example. Some people fall in love with others that are not good for them. There are all sorts of permutations of these kinds of themes. Boy, don't just hate it when you can't get favors with that terminal. There can be no doubt that eros is connected to one of the strongest instinctual drives that humans and other animals like us have, namely the drive to reproduce in the struggle for survival. It doesn't feel that way, but that's what it is at bottom, and it can make people behave in very irrational ways. In the final analysis, that's what got people like O.J. Simpson, Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby, Anthony Weiner, Al Franken, Bill Clinton, and all these others, that's what's got them in so much trouble. And many men who can't handle their testosterone, of course, wind up in prison or worse. And the prisons are mainly filled with men because they can't handle their testosterone. And of course, when a dead body shows up, what's the first thing the cops do? Try to figure out who that person's current or past sexual partners were. Love gone wrong is what the Greeks actually call mania. It means something different today, but that's what they call it then. Now, when things don't go wrong, when they go right, it can be a wonderful thing. It certainly feels wonderful to people who fall in love. And how many of you here have had that experience personally? Well, so not everybody. How many have had it more than once? Okay. How many have had it three times? This is an interesting question. How many times can you go through that? I don't know that there is a limit, you know. How many husbands did Elizabeth Taylor have? Well, the psychologists and neuroscientists have been studying how it happens and what's going on in the brain when that's happening. Among other things, changes in the activity of various brain regions have been found in alterations in neurotransmitter levels. But those facts are kind of trivial, aren't they? I mean, after all, something is going on in the brain when people feel giddy about their love interest, can't stop thinking of them, and want to be with them all the time, and so on. Something's going on in the brain, and that's how the brain works, with neurotransmitters and so forth. But all sorts of additional interesting questions can be asked, I think. I mean, what exactly sets off these changes that cause the falling in love feelings? We do know that moderate levels of stress promote social bonds, including pair bonding. So it's not surprising, for example, in wartime conditions that lead to strong friendships among those swept up. Do you still keep track of some of your old buddies in the military? Those are very strong bonds that people form under conditions of stress. Well, or think of Casablanca, right? Classic film where the love relationship during war. And it may also be asked, what will prolong or shorten or even stop or prevent what happens when people fall in love? I mean, it's such a good feeling, you know, people should want to figure out, well, you know, what kinds of things do prolong it, because people like to have that feeling. It's been reported that substances in chocolate, phenylethylamine, for example, might foster feelings of romantic love, but guess what? There's no scientific evidence really yet of that being true. But it's entirely reasonable to suppose that medications of some sort, either ones that we already have or that might be developed in the future, could affect the neurochemical processes of falling in love. Lots of possibilities, and some possibilities that may not be welcome. Right? You see these psychics on the street corner, right? Make your love interest fall in love with you. They're going to cast a magic spell, but one of it could actually be done. fascinating thing is that other forms of love are being studied more scientifically also. For example, there are people interested in compassion, which roughly equates to that Greek idea of agape, famously claimed by Christians who, if they could, make it their exclusive property. It turns out there is at Stanford School of Medicine in California, a Center for Compassion and Altruism Research. You can look them up online. There are some interesting things there. Actually, the Dalai Lama had some role in that outfit getting going. And there's some interesting items on their website about the neural correlates of compassion and empathy, as well as they're looking at what kinds of education or interventions can help people feel and act with greater compassion and caring. One of these involves ongoing studies of people who have been adversely affected by violent conflict, but have nevertheless managed to adopt peaceful attitudes and beliefs instead of being brutalized and turning out terrible and getting worse. Just the opposite. What distinguishes those people? And that would be an interesting question to answer. Another is directed at figuring out if people's compassion for others plays a role in their political preferences. Because, of course, whatever political party you're in, whatever your political views, you think the ones on the other side, they're the cold-hearted, not compassionate people. But if you get in there and start measuring, maybe you can make some sense of that. Now, there's certainly a lot of unanswered questions about other forms of love. What is it that causes, for example, attachment disorders? How many have heard of that? These are disorders where something goes wrong in the formation of normal attachments, for example, by children to their parents or other primary caregivers. This is a problem that is plagued with quackery, since there's little in the way of proven treatments, and yet the problems can be severe, just really difficult. This case, how many have heard of the case of Candace Newmaker? Colorado. She underwent this quacky rebirthing attachment therapy and was suffocated to death. And the two main therapists involved with that got prison terms. Not that that brings a little girl back. Another sort of love with a different character that serves different purposes is what the ancient Greeks called philautia. Dissect that, right? The phil, like love, like philosophy, love of wisdom. Philautia. Akia means autobiography, love of self. Now this carries connotations, obviously, for selfishness, vanity, narcissism. But those are really examples of love gone wrong, so some mixture of mania. The Greeks recognized, though, that a healthy love of self was necessary to be able to love others. You know, we think that's such a modern thing. Oh, everybody knows that. The ancient Greeks knew that. We call it today self-esteem, or having a sense of self-worth. Having compassion for ourselves. This is very important, but again, it's difficult terrain. We hear of children being given awards even when they don't accomplish anything just to supposedly help their self-esteem. I mean, really, do the adults who do this, do they really think children are so stupid? And believers, of course, famously say to us, well, God loves you. Like, that should make any difference to you, even if it were true. It doesn't help those of us who don't find the concept of God to be even coherent. So if self-esteem requires the love of God, then there's truly no reason to think well of ourselves. But as freethinkers, of course, we have a different problem. We want to believe in things that are true. We don't want to believe in things just because they make us feel good. As T.H. Huxley said in his letter to Kingsley in response, remember that, you got to go read the whole letter, but he says in response to an invitation to accept the idea of an afterlife, he expressed this idea. It doesn't help to tell me that the aspirations of mankind, that my own highest aspirations even lead me towards the doctrine of immortality. I doubt the fact to begin with, but if it be so even, what is this but in grand words asking me to believe a thing because I like it? And we see that all the time. You believe in this because it makes you feel good, you like it. That's one of our little dogmatic things probably, but it's not really a dogma, it's just the way you are. So there's something similar when it comes to philautia. Why should we believe that we ourselves have value and worth? Why should we have compassion towards ourselves? Why should we love ourselves? Well, there seems to be nothing like an instinctual attachment to one's parents or that neurochemical falling in love experience. There's nothing like that to help us love ourselves. On the contrary, unless one is continually, well, there is one thing, okay? So suppose you're continually told by everyone how great you are. You're given millions of dollars for singing songs or playing a ball game. Or everywhere you go, you're preceded by a brass band playing Hail to the Chief. I guess then you probably think you're pretty hot stuff. But most of us don't go through life with that. And even the people who do are... Seriously, this is not... the star and the celebrities, they do get that, suffer from depression and get involved in self-destructive behaviors. We all, you know, see that in the news. Might this be a cultural thing? Is it something that centuries of Christianity with its irreturnable worthless sinner who deserves to burn in hell? Maybe that's had some influence. It's a puzzle. But there are reasons to experience philautia, to feel compassion towards oneself. For one, no reason not to. It might not be rational, but it's not against rationality. It's not anti-rational. It's not like believing in psychic powers of gods and ghosts. It may be, for another, it's good to make an effort to understand others, right? To realize that they are what they are because of many things that happen to them through no fault of their own. That they're trying as best they can, as they understand or misunderstand their situations, to get to a better place. So why not consider that of ourselves? We're in the same boat, aren't we? It's just as good a thing to realize that these things about and have empathy for ourselves. Indeed, it's the epitome of objectivity. We all think it's great to be objective. Consider oneself from the standpoint of a disinterested, neutral observer, and we should try to do this more often. It's also worth considering that each one of us is here because we won. We won the game of survival. We are, each of us, the product of millions of years of evolution. We got here. All those other ones fell by the wayside. And each of us is a statistically wildly improbable result of chance, for each of us is the product of one of tens of thousands of eggs that our mothers had when they entered the reproductive years, and product also of one of hundreds of billions of sperm cells produced by our fathers. And of course, our parents beat those same odds, and you just go back a few generations, the math quickly adds up. With the same sort of argument that creationists make to the effect that the natural beginnings of life and its subsequent evolution by natural selection just could not have happened, we can prove that none of us actually exist. But we do exist. So if there's any value in life, and as far as we know, we are the only organisms that even can understand the idea of value, and maybe any ideas at all, each of us possesses that value. And finally, although there are many other ways to consider the matter, if it's true that one must love oneself in order to love others, that's a very strong and practical reason to love oneself. Do you want to love others? Then you must learn to love yourself. Just like you want to do anything else. You want to play an instrument? You want to drive a car? You want to work in a given job? You have to learn what's necessary to do those things. This certainly doesn't exhaust the subject of love, but there will be more of our services and more February TC Web services where we can consider these things. And I think we've got a little time left. I really would like to hear what you all think about this. I need to respond to this call also, and it's now 11:16. John, would you come up and just lead a little discussion?
Okay.
There's some final slides here too that should not be missed. Free thought is not free. We have these rainbow colored boxes in the back of the room. They are hungry for your cash, jewels, negotiable instruments, and so forth. Both points have been too. And the main reason to give us your money, just the big generic reason that we can do together what is difficult or impossible. I mean, you just can't sit at home watching YouTube videos having this kind of group experience. So help us promote your values and demonstrate your commitment to be the future you wish to see. We're going to have skeptics in Sunday school next, and John will respond to some stick over here that can be passed around so it can all be heard.
You just have to speak pretty close to the little metal.
Yourself.
exalt the deity.
You know, it almost sounds like it reversed the terms of the idea of a formal of a fallacy there, right? You know, if it could be stated as a formal argument, then maybe it would be a bit easier to analyze that relationship.
I kind of saw it as, well, a false sense of humility or something like that. I'm special because everybody else thinks they're special, and I don't think I am. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Well, I'll say, if I were on a boat or something, and it's sinking, and only one life can be saved. Of course, I'm only looking out for me, believe me. But really, when you look at the value to humanity, and me with my limited resources, and limited lifespan, it's a tier point. And the other person is someone who is in research, that's a doctor or whatever, and there is going to be very beneficial to humanity in the future, then weighing as to how much my value would be to continue living versus this other person. And I think there are value judgments. But I saw the show that person died.
Well, I guess
I'm
not tend to think that people who display arrogance don't really have self. They don't have self-love in truth. They're very insecure, and so they put on, even to themselves, they don't really think about it that way, but that they need to put on a show of being better than other people because they don't have that internal core. He says, I don't have to, you know, put down other people or degrade other people and show my superiority because I know that I have self-worth. And as far as the boat sinking situation, I mean, that's an extreme situation where you make a calculation that this other person's life is worth more than your life. So that would be an altruistic situation. But those are very rare. And I don't know that they should be expanded to other situations. In general, you have to love yourself as much as you love anyone else. You can't love anyone else unless you love yourself first.
I think that's a good point. I happen to have done some reading on narcissistic personality disorder, just because that's sort of things in my life that make it pertinent. And there's a kind of great disagreement as to whether or not narcissistic people that suffer from narcissistic personality disorder really have low self-esteem or not. It looks like it doesn't hold up very well. These people really do seem to love themselves and think that the sun rises and sets on their head. I think the problem there gets into another level, and that is if you really love yourself, what's good for yourself? What's good for yourself is to have regard for other people more than what some of these people who think they're the most important thing. I mean, it's good to think you're really important, but part of what makes you really important is your need to understand others and to be able to love others. And if you love yourself too much, then there's like basically nothing left to love others with because what you want is the top priority. And it's not that you intend to hurt others, it's just that it's not even a consideration that when you act and others get hurt. Any other good ideas about that? What are people doing for a Valentine's Day? Or
you mean St. Valentine's Day?
St. Valentine's Day. Yeah, it has some kind of a ugly history behind it, too. I read somebody was in jail and yeah, and so on. Yeah, right.
One question I would have about narcissists, maybe you know more, is do most narcissists also feel that they need to be loved by other people and not just love themselves?
Now, there's different varieties of narcissists. Some of our narcissists are in political life, you know, where they just, you know, get all the adulation and all of that sort of thing. But then there are other narcissists who apparently their sense of you know, it's like, oh, poor me, the victim. I'm the ultimate victim. And, you know, I'm much more of a victim than anybody else. You know? And of course, we sometimes meet people. I'm so humble. I'm just more humble than anybody else in the whole world. So apparently these kinds of disorders come with different flavors. And of course, some narcissists are so bad. I mean, those are the people that, you know, when they get married and they kill their spouse and then they move on to the next one. You know, the Black Widow type people. If you watch some of these true crime shows.
Well,
go ahead.
Well, I know at least a couple of people that they like to play the victim. I'm not an expert on that, but I think it's very potential givers.
It's a common trope, isn't it? I mean, we even see, you know, Christians talking always about how, oh, we're so persecuted. Oh, we don't, all these bad things are happening.
Even today.
Right, yeah. I mean, look at our money. It says, in God we trust, we're being persecuted.
And not only that, I mean, how many TV stations do you own? How much money do you make? And I mean, you don't pay taxes. What else? Every corner, you have a church at every corner. What else do you want? I don't get it.
Yeah, so, you know, again, this is sort of like disorders of love, which at bottom is just a matter of what you put value on. And, you know, the traditional religions just don't really talk about it. They don't really explore it. You have to go to psychologies and other sources to really learn very much about this. But there's a lot of material out there, and there needs to be more material, because I think people do need guidance in how to live more loving lives. And I think Merlin and I were talking about this, too, that, you know, as we go through life, we should try to behave in ways that make us worthy, maybe that's not the right word, but in other words, when you try to contribute some good to the world and leave the world a little bit better each day that you go to the world, even if nobody appreciates it, you know what you've done. And that's the interesting thing, too, about this whole, you know, God business. Yeah, there is somebody in the world who knows your every thought and everything you've done and so on, and that's you. So you have to, in that sense, kind of be your own God, like we're often accused of being. But what people who say that about us mean is that we want to, like, make up our own arbitrary moral rules, which just shows how bankrupt their idea of morality is, that they think God can just say anything and, you know, whatever he wants goes. Whereas, of course, we read the Bible and see genocide and all these things and say, that ain't any God that I want to worship. So.
And I have friends like that, and they say, well, that's not what I believe. Well, it's like a cafeteria. You can pick and choose what you want to believe, and we go, what you want to discover. That's not true. That's not what you are.
Sometimes it's said.
But it's in the book that
right.
you believe in. It's in the, well, I don't believe in that, but I believe it. So you pick and choose.
You can never nail them down. That's what I'm saying. There's a saying, it's like trying to nail Jell-O to a wall. Can you imagine that? Get that Jell-O to be nailed to the wall. Anybody else with any comment?
Just a comment. Sure. Randall.
Randall.
Yeah, sorry, I don't have the name tag. I know I've mentioned this before. One of my favorite sources of learning fallacies and such, there's a podcast called You're Not So Smart. And they actually, about a year ago, they did a series of three parts on the backfire effect, and they just released part four, like, a week ago or so, and I thought it was really interesting, and, like, just to give a little tidbit, when you are seeking to change someone's mind, what is it that you're changing, right? And that question, and how you answer it, and how you approach that, could be completely different, and they kind of touch on that and how, I just recommend listening.
Well, give an answer on that.
No, that's part of the problem. There is no answer, right? That's one of those, or we don't know enough about it, really, and it really depends on what the subject is. But yeah, there's, I can't explain. It's getting endless.
Well, hopefully you all heard things here today that will make you wonder and think for the rest of the month. We meet again in only 4 weeks because, of course, February is short and only has 28 days this year. So it's going to be March 4th, just like today was February 4th. Edwin, where are you? There he is. Edwin is not going to be here next month. So we do need someone else to take all the gear. Is there anyone for sure who's going to be here next month? I know you've done that sometimes, John, but man, I don't want to draft you into it, but if you are definitely going to be here next month, is that something you could do?
Okay.
Well, as I say, we're always looking for volunteers to help shoulder the burden and many hands make short work. And we want to get to know all of you. Those of you who are newcomers, welcome to our family. We hope you're able to come again and we'll find something here valuable that that you enjoy. And we certainly value you for being here because you're one of us. We're the same sort of people who care about these kinds of questions and like to think about things that maybe other people, oh, that's just a silly thing when you're changing, when you're trying to change somebody else's mind. And then, what a silly, foolish question. But of course, it's a fascinating one, as are most all of the other things we deal with here. We're going to get together at Jason's, the one that's over in MacArthur. Who all plans to go to that? I'm going to plan to go there.